Hello everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to AVO's webinar series. Today's topic is an introduction to power quality. My name is Ron Spitero, and I'm the marketing manager for AVO Training Institute, and I'll be your moderator for today's presentation and supporting you on technical issues or questions for our presenter. On the right side of your screen, you will see a control panel that looks similar to this one. You can submit questions at any time during our presentation by typing in the box highlighted in red, and I will read the question out during the Q&A segment at the end of the webinar. All attendees are eligible to receive one NEDA CTD and one professional development hour credit. You will receive your attendance confirmation in an email within a few days after the webinar. That email will also include a copy of this PowerPoint presentation and a link to the recorded video of the webinar if you'd like to watch it again or share it with colleagues. Remember, you can ask questions at any time during the presentation and they will be answered after the webinar ends. Our presenter today is Andy Sagel, Mega Product Manager. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Thank you for joining us today, Andy.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. And what I'd like to do is just start off with a simple question. What is power quality? I hear many people give many different explanations about it. And the IEEE definition of power quality is, it's the concept of powering and grounding sensitive equipment in a manner that's suitable for the operation of that equipment. So what does that mean? Well, what it means is that if I have a piece of equipment that's working fine, it doesn't have a power quality problem. However, if I have a piece of equipment that's overheating, that's tripping out, that's having issues, and it's due to the incoming power, then I do have a power quality problem. Simply, that's what it means. So what we're going to do in this presentation is we're going to cover at a pretty high level some of the most typical power quality phenomena that we encounter today. These will include undervoltages, overvoltages, dips or sags in swells, as well as transients, unbalance, flicker, harmonics, THD or total harmonic distortion, as well as total demand distortion, and RVC, also known as rapid voltage change. We're going to discuss what these are and what they cause, what their problems is. So first, let's just start off with undervoltage. An undervoltage is defined as a decrease in the RMS voltage of less than 0.9 percentile units for a duration longer than 1 minute. So 0.9 percentile units, basically that would be 90% of the voltage. So if my voltage is 100 volts, if it drops below 90, I'm below my 0.9 percentile units. Now, for an undervoltage to occur, it has to also last longer than 1 minute. That's important for an undervoltage scenario. So let me ask, what can undervoltages cause? What are the problems with them? Well, one of the key issues you're going to run into with undervoltages has to do with motors. A motor has to supply a constant power. So when the voltage goes low, the current has to increase in order to maintain that power. So as the current increases, your heating effects increase. Power equals I squared times R. So as the current goes up, the heating effects go up. Okay. So undervoltages can cause issues with motors, overheating them, basically. So what will cause undervoltages? Well, undervoltage conditions can be caused due to overloaded lines, as well as large loads that are turning on. Overvoltages. An overvoltage is an RMS increase in AC voltage greater than 1.1 percentile units, or 110% of the average RMS. and this will last longer than 1 minute as well. Typical values can be 110% to 120%. And overvoltages can be the result of reactive compensation, such as switching in of capacitor banks. Solar cells are also a common cause of overvoltages, especially in residential and small commercial facilities where you have the solar panels put on, and they will start jumping up the voltage on those phases, as well as poor system voltage regulation. So what issues can overvoltages cause? Well, to be blunt, the issues can be you can trip a breaker, obviously, excessive energy use on resistive devices, reduced life and lighting, and also, again, with motors, you can get a core saturation. And if motors go into a core saturation, again, you'll get into overheating situations as well. We also have voltage dips, sags, and swells. Now, you may hear the term dip and sag used interchangeably. Well, that's because in the United States, we use the term sag to represent a decrease in RMS voltage less than, again, 0.9 percentile units or 90% of the nominal, but this time it's for a duration of less than 1 minute. Okay. However, in outside the United States, the term dips is typically used. Whenever you see dips or sags, they're talking about the exact same thing. There is no difference between them. They're used interchangeably. It's just where you are in the world. And a voltage swell, this is basically the voltage increases to 110% or 1.1 percentile units above nominal for less than 1 minute. So when we look at under voltage and over voltage conditions, these last longer than a minute. Dips, sags, and swells last less than a minute. And sags and dips, these are your most common power quality events you're going to see. They cannot be prevented. Because as impedances change on your system during the day from loads being turned on and off, you're going to see dips and swells occur. The issues, though, these can cause is one of the biggest issues you're going to see with or sags is that, as well as swells, is they can shut down processes, especially in industrial applications. So we can have lines running, and you can get a sag or a swell that occurs, and it can shut the process off. And your key issue there is if your process shuts off, how long does it take to restart? This can be a huge financial burden. And there's also the prospect that if the manufacturing process is time sensitive, you could actually lose the product that's in process of being manufactured. So these are some of the issues that have to be taken into account when looking for sags and swells. So what causes these? Well, voltage sags are typically caused, the most common cause is large loads turning on. When a large load turns on, such as a motor, what will occur is you'll get a large inrush of current that will occur. As the large inrush occurs, you're going to get a momentary sag in the voltage that will occur. Okay. And again, these can be caused by, the most common cause is large loads turning on, and these happen on a daily basis. They're not the only cause. You can also have sags caused by poor connections, as well as source faults. If you have a signal line to ground fault, okay, we can see a sag until the protective devices kick in. Voltage swells, these are most commonly caused by loads, large loads, turning off. You have a large motor that has a lot of energy tied up in the magnetic field. You turn it off. Now that energy has come down, we're going to see a swell as the voltage rises. So this can cause a breaker to turn off or it could trip something out. And also, we can also see these can also occur on the source side as well. So if you have a delta system and you have a phase-to-phase fault, those phases will go low. The other phase will go high. So you can see an overvoltage there as well, or a swell that occurs. It all depends how fast the relay protection kicks in. So, how do you actually measure sags and swells? And this is a question that has come up for us several times, so what I'd like to do is just get into a little bit of that here. And in a Class A instrument, a sag, the way it's actually detected is we set a lower limit. That limit is typically 10% of the nominal voltage. So if your nominal voltage is 120, it's typically be set at 108 volts. So when the RMS value, RMS half cycle value, now this doesn't mean that the RMS is calculated every half, it is calculated every half cycle, but it takes a one cycle window. So every half cycle, a one cycle window is used to calculate an RMS value. When that value drops below the sag trigger, it initiates a sag event. That event will continue until the voltage rises above the trigger plus a hysteresis value, which is normally set at 2%. So it will have to rise above about 110 volts before the event actually stops. Why do we do this? Why not just have it where it drops below 108 and comes back above 108 to be the stop? The reason is to avoid false triggers. Is that if your voltage, if you're at the end of your line and you have a relatively low voltage, slight variations could cause multiple false events. So a hysteresis is always used at the end, so that when it drops below its trigger, it has to come above the trigger plus the hysteresis point. And this is how they're actually recorded in Class A instrumentation. That's for a single phase. Now for a polyphase sag, the event actually starts when any single phase drops below the trigger point. Then all three phases rise above the, have to be above the trigger point plus the hysteresis for the event to stop. So when we're actually looking at sag data, this is what we're looking at. Where it begins is where it dropped below. Where it ends is where all three phases have come back into tolerance, which again is typically plus or minus 10% of nominal. Swells are measured the exact same way, except it's a swell we're looking at. Typically, the trigger is going to be 110% of your nominal voltage. So at 120, your swell will be set at 132. And if the voltage rises above 132, your event starts. That event will continue until the voltage comes down below 132 minus the hysteresis of 2%, and then it will stop. Again, the reason for this is to make sure that we don't get false events that occur. So this is the proper methodology of how to measure dips, or I should say sags and swells. Okay. Now, let's go into transients. When we were talking about sags and swells, we were talking about RMS events. This means we were dealing with RMS voltages. We were comparing RMS voltages to particular triggers. Transients, what we're going to be now looking at, is what's called subcycle events. These are events that last less than one cycle. Generally, there are two types of transients. You have the impulse transient, and you also have an oscillatory transient. Now, the problem you can run into with transients is that they will degrade insulation over time. This can either happen by having one large transient, it has to be of substantial energy to break down the insulation, but more commonly, what you will see is repeated lower magnitude transients hitting particular insulation and wires, transformers, motors, and it will slowly degrade that insulation until the insulation fails. Why does this happen? Well, what we can do is we can look at it as a point of view of looking at it like a capacitor. A capacitor, When you apply voltage to it, it will pass the voltage until it charges up, then it will stop passing it. The capacitor is basically consists of two conductors and an insulator between them. A cable is very much the same thing. You have two conductors, you have your inner conductor, and you have a shield. Then you also have the insulation in between it. As you have transients that pass through these cables, those transients will pass through that insulation on the cable just like it would pass through a capacitor. The cable basically is a capacitor. For any of you, any of those that have ever had to replace a cable, one of the first things you have to do is discharge it because it holds a charge just like a capacitor does. So the transients will slowly break down that insulation. Now, when we look at the transient, the frequency of the transient, we say one of the properties of the cable is it has impedance. And part of that impedance is capacitive reactance. Capacitive reactance, this is basically the formula for it. Capacitive reactance equals 1 over 2 pi FC. Frequency times capacitance. As the frequency of the transient goes up, the capacitive reactance goes down. So the higher the frequency is, the easier it can go through the insulation of the cable. However, we also have to keep in mind is that the shorter, the higher the frequency of the transient, the shorter the period, so the less energy it has as well. So although it goes through the cable much quicker, it has less energy. But repeatedly hitting the cable will eventually cause that cable to fail. So that's the key issue with transients that you're going to see is breakdown of insulation. It doesn't just have to be in cables. It can also be in electronics. It can be, obviously, in motors, transformers. Commonly, when motors and transformers get hit by repeated transients, you can actually see the coil shorting out. Typically, it will be in the first few coils because that's where the energy is being dissipated. So, what causes transients? Well, impulse transients, the major cause of impulse transients is lightning. Okay? And I'm not really referring to a direct lightning strike. To be honest, if you have a direct lightning strike, there is no question of what happened. You're going to know right away what happened. What really happens, though, that where we see impulse transients occur is when lightning is when lightning bolt comes down. These can be over 5 miles long, and they can reach temperatures over 20,000 degrees Celsius. They create a very large magnetic pulse when they come down. When a magnetic field crosses the wire, it induces a current in that wire. So we actually will see an impulse transient due to the magnetic field caused by the lightning that's crossing the wire. Now, typically when we see this, what we're going to see is a unidirectional transient as shown here in this image. So the characteristic of it is it's only really going in one direction. And this is typically the sign of an impulse transient. And as I said, one of the major causes of that is lightning. It's not the only cause, but it is a major cause of it. The other common transient that we're going to see is the oscillatory transient. And this is a lower frequency transient. And if you look at the image here, one of the characteristics of it is that it rings out. The most common cause of the oscillatory transient is capacitor banks switching into the circuit. As during the day, as industries start ramping up, they're turning on motors. These motors put an inductive load on the system. They create a phase shift between the voltage and the current. As they do this, the power factor begins to drop. Your K-bar goes up, your KW goes down, and your power factor drops. In order to correct this, a capacitor bank will be put into the circuit. This will bring your power factor back up. When that that capacitor bank kicks in, it will create an oscillatory transient, and that is what we see here. So when you see the signature, we know a cap bank is being switched into the circuit. One of the things we've seen happen when these trip in is they can affect systems such as UPSs. UPSs are designed to turn on rapidly when you have a power outage. But if they're actually too sensitive, when an oscillatory transient hits, they can actually turn on multiple times very quickly and for no reason. So sometimes we have to reduce the sensitivity of the UPS in order to keep it from tripping on and off multiple times every time a capacitor bank is switched into the circuit. Whoops, overshot. There we go. We also have EFTs, extremely fast transients. These have rise and fall times in the nanosecond region. Sometimes you'll hear people talking about measuring transients down to 1 microsecond or less even. And the question is, what impact do they really have, these very fast transients? Most transients will be in, you can get the 64 microsecond range or even the millisecond range. But these, when you start getting into these very fast transients, what impact do they have? If we think about it, their frequency is so high, they're going to have very low energy to. So now, in a distribution system, these will be dampened out by just a few meters of cable. So really, when we look at large distribution systems, these very high-speed transients don't have that big of an impact on them. It's more the oscillatory and impulse transients that will have more of the impact. The where these can have an impact is in areas where you have short cable runs, such as offshore oil rigs, mines. Also, when we look at residential or small commercial solar, solar panels, unlike wind, if I have a wind turbine and the wind suddenly changes speed, the turbine does not change speed instantaneously. It has a certain torque to it that slows it. But when the sun changes its output or changes its luminosity, solar tiles react almost instantaneously. So if they don't have proper voltage regulation, they can create very fast transients. And in these small environments, such as residential, small commercial, these transients can end up hitting electronic devices. And over time, those electronic devices can have their filters fail and can cause these devices to fail themselves. So, we've talked about sags, swells, and transients. Now let's go on to unbalance. Unbalance is defined as a condition in a polyphase system in which the RMS value of the line voltages, or fundamental component, or the phase angle between consecutive line voltages are not equal per IEEE 1159 and IEC 61000-4-27. So what does that mean? Basically, when we have a three-phase system or a polyphase system, the voltages on the systems should be, in an ideal system, will be balanced and 120 degrees apart. However, that is seldom the case. When we have, on our three-phase systems, typically we will see some unbalance on them. We're going to see unbalance due to mainly the loads. Typically, all unbalanced situations are going to be load-side problems, due to large single-phase loads that will be on the system. Now, unbalance can occur either from voltage or shift in the phase angle. When back in time, we used to measure unbalance using an ANSI system. where basically what we did was we took all three phases, we would average them together. We take the phase-to-phase voltage, average them together, come up with this average number, and then look at each individual phase and see which one deviated the farthest. And then we would say, this is what our percent of balance is. The problem with this system is this is an approximation, because you're only dealing with one phase, the worst phase. Today, when we measure unbalance, we use the phase sequence components to measure unbalance. Okay. When we look at the phase sequence components, what we're actually doing here is we are looking at the magnetic rotation. So what we're going to do is look at the ABC versus CBA. Okay. So we're going to take phase A, B, and C. We shift phase B by 120 degrees and phase C by 240 degrees and add them together. When we add them together, we still get a good sine wave. Okay? This is our reference sine wave. Okay? It's going to be our positive sequence component, now, or our positive balance. Now, then we take phase B, shift it by 240, and phase C by 120 and add them together. You'll have zero. In a perfectly balanced system, it'll be zero. That's your negative sequence component. Now, if there's any deviation in voltage or phase angle, you're going to see it in your negative sequence unbalance. So when we look at our unbalance through today's standards, you're going to see you're going to get the negative sequence value. You'll also get a zero sequence value. The zero sequence is basically looking at strictly amplitude. It's not looking at an angle. Okay. When we look at unbalance, we want to take in our negative sequence factor. This will be looking at the negative sequence unbalance compared to the positive sequence of balance. This value should not exceed basically 2% of the voltage. If it does, it's going to start causing some problems. Zero sequence unbalance can create high neutral currents. And again, that should be a low level as well. So what problems does unbalance cause? The most common problem you'll see from unbalance has to do with three-phase motors. Just a 1% voltage unbalance in a three-phase motor can cause up to a 6 to 10% current unbalance in the three-phase motor. This will create high heating effects. So when I'm looking at this, if I were to have a failed motor and take it apart, if I looked at those three phases, those coils, if all those coils were black, or dark, I should say, that would be an indication that I might have an undervoltage scenario affecting all the coils. But if I take it apart and I see one or two coils are much darker than the others, that's an indication of an unbalance that's occurring. Okay. And again, we want to make sure that our voltages are balanced going into those motors. Otherwise, just a, for example, a 2% voltage imbalance can be a 12 to 20% current unbalance in the motor, depending on the design of the motor itself. So this is one of the key issues you have and why you want to keep your voltages well balanced in your systems. Okay? So what we want to take away from this is that when we're actually performing unbalance tests, we want to look at the negative sequence unbalance and make sure it's less than 2%. That's typically the standard that is used today for it. Okay. Flicker. I'm sure many people have heard of the term flicker, and this is probably one of the most misunderstood power quality phenomena, because flicker is a very specific problem that's related to human perception. And it applies only to incandescent lights, not all types of lights. and is not a general term for voltage variations. Okay. Humans can be very sensitive to light flicker. And the light flicker is caused by voltage fluctuations. But when we measure flicker, we're actually looking at the human perception of the light flicker. Some time ago, some studies were done. And basically, they took people into rooms and they used incandescent lights, 60-watt incandescent lights, and they were testing different rates of flicker to see how the people responded. And what they found was that these were tested, by the way, at 120 volts 60 hertz and 230 volts 50 hertz. What they found was as the rate of light flicker approached 8%, or 8 hertz, the voltage only had to change a very slight amount before the flickering light became noticeable to the human eye and became an irritant. As the frequency of the flicker went further away from 8 hertz, either below or above, the voltage had to vary more in order to cause the light to flicker where it would be noticeable or cause a problem. Knowing this, a weighted curve was developed in order to measure light flicker. So, the way it's done today is we have a rolling average that's taken of the voltage. We then look at the instantaneous value, and we compare it to that rolling average. This is then multiplied by the weighted curve. And this creates, there's two different curves, one at 120 60 hertz and one at 230 50 hertz. And this creates an end unit called a percentile unit. The percentile unit then goes through two statistical analyses in order to calculate two flicker values. The first one is called short-term flicker, or PST. And it's calculated using the flicker percentile units. It's calculated and aggregated every 10 minutes. So you have one PST interval or short-term flicker interval for every 10 minutes. You also have what's called the PLT or long-term flicker. This is calculated based on the PST or the short-term flicker, and it's calculated once every 2 hours. Okay. So with all this said, what does it mean? Okay, well, it gets real simple. If the measured PST is less than 1.0, then your flicker levels should not really be irritating someone's eyes. If they're greater than 1.0, then the flicker can be causing an irritation. What is important to realize about this is this only applies to incandescent lighting. Other types of lightings cannot be used. You can't use flicker to the flicker measurement to directly evaluate them because the flicker measurement uses a weighted curve which was designed specifically for incandescent lighting. Okay. A little later in this presentation, we're going to go over some other things that can cause light deviations in rapid light deviations in different types of systems, such as fluorescent lighting and other systems. But as far as flicker goes, this is based on incandescent lighting. Harmonics. This is quite a hot topic. Many people are dealing with harmonic issues. And in the past, harmonics were not that big of an issue. Today, they are growing in importance and becoming much more problematic due to the loads that are now being put on the systems. Harmonics are a sinusoidal component of a periodic wave that are frequencies that are have frequencies that are multiples of the fundamental frequency. So, what that basically means is that if my fundamental frequency is 60 hertz, That would be considered my first order harmonic. My second order harmonic would be 2 times 60 or 120 hertz. My third order would be 3 times 60 or 180 hertz and so forth. So what problems do harmonics cause? Well, in general, they cause heating issues. They can create heating in neutral wires. They can cause neutral wires to overheat. They can cause motors to overheat, transformers to overheat, and they can cause electronic failures as well. And we just talked about that. So, in the past, I said harmonics weren't that big of an issue. Well, that's because the primary loads in the past were what was called linear loads. They were incandescent lights, motors. These are linear loads, meaning that as the voltage changes, the current will change with that voltage. It follows the path of the voltage. So I'll get a sinusoidal wave on my voltage and a sinusoidal wave of my current. Today, most loads are nonlinear loads. This means that they do not follow the sinusoidal wave of the voltage. The reason is most electronics we use today actually require DC power, not AC power. We look at any computer system, any printers, anything of that nature. They all actually work off DC. We plug into the AC, and we have to have a rectifier that converts the AC to DC. When this is done, those rectifiers are only pulling current at the peak of the wave, as shown in this image here. So they're not following the path. They're not creating a sinusoidal wave. They're not following the voltage. They're only drawing current at the peaks of the wave. And these will be seen as current harmonics, and we're going to see them wherever we look. We'll always see current harmonics. However, current harmonics can create voltage harmonics. When we have current harmonics, typically they're not going to propagate through a transformer. However, what happens when the current harmonic becomes so great that the voltage can no longer support it? You're drawing all your power at the peak of the wave, but now the voltage can no longer support that. So what happens is you get a little tiny dip at the peak of the wave, which will look like something in this image here. This is referred to as flat topping. This is also a form of third harmonic. Harmonics can be categorized based on their order. You can have odd harmonics, which are generally they're the odd number harmonics. They're 5, 7, etc. Even harmonics are harmonics with even numbers. And triplins are odd harmonics that are multiples of 3. 3, 9, 15, these are all triplets. So what's the difference between them? Well, when we look at the harmonics on our system, we would expect to see odd number harmonics. This is because when we take AC and rectify it to DC, we're rectifying both the positive section of the wave and the negative section. It's a symmetrical rectification, which means that we should have symmetrical harmonics or odd number harmonics. When we start seeing large numbers of even harmonics, that's an indication that something's wrong. Even harmonics will be non-symmetrical. This is because now you have a rectifier that's not rectifying both sides of the wave. You have a faulty rectifier somewhere. So it's creating a non-symmetrical waveform, or an even harmonic. Typically, even harmonics should be very small. When we start seeing large numbers of them, they're an indication that we have a problem on the system, a faulty rectifier somewhere. We also have triplets. Again, these are odd harmonics that are multiples of three. These are a special case of odd harmonics. These, when you deal with different frequencies harmonics, when you add them up, okay, like they would add up like you were looking at a neutral, remember that if we were to take phase A, B, and C and add them together, they should come out to zero on the neutral. But they don't due to unbalanced lows and also harmonics. When I add up my different frequencies of harmonics, we're going to have peaks and valleys that will cancel out. What's unique about the triplet harmonics is they're all in phase with one another. So they don't cancel out. They add together. So triplets can create large neutral currents. So if we're looking at our neutral lines and we're seeing large currents on them, besides looking for unbalanced unbalanced loads, we want to look at our triplet harmonics. Our third harmonic, our ninth harmonic, and our 15th harmonic are prime culprits there. And when we look at things such as commercial power supplies that are used in computer systems, basically their primary harmonic they create is a third harmonic or a triplet harmonic. Harmonics can also be categorized as sequence components. They can be categorized as positive sequence, negative sequence, or zero sequence. A positive sequence harmonic creates, that harmonic will have a magnetic field that rotates in the same direction as the magnetic field of the fundamental. A negative sequence harmonic will have a magnetic field that rotates in the opposite direction of the fundamental. These can create issues in motors. When you have a motor, you have a phase rotation that's occurring that keeps the motor turning. If I have negative sequence harmonics in there, those magnetic fields will rotate opposite that. They can create counter-rotational currents within the motor, and they can lead to inefficiencies as well as cause vibrations in the motors. So if we're looking at motor issues, we want to look at our negative sequence harmonics. We also have zero sequence harmonics, which just like triplets, these are harmonics that have no rotational value of their magnetic field, so they add together. And these, again, can cause very high neutral currents. So if we're looking at high neutral currents, again, we want to look at our triplets or basically our zero sequence harmonics. So this is how I already covered that. Okay. Harmonics. How do we determine? I already said what's a positive, we defined a positive and negative sequence harmonic as well as a zero sequence harmonic. How do we know which harmonics are what? It's pretty easy to tell when you have, you know, odd harmonics and even harmonics. Just look at the number. It's either odd or even. How do you know whether the harmonics zero sequence, negative sequence, or positive sequence, negative sequence, or zero sequence? Well, that also is relatively simple. They basically go in order. The first order harmonic, as we discussed, is your fundamental frequency. In this case, we'll say 60 hertz. So my first order is 60 hertz. That's a positive sequence harmonic. The next one, my second order harmonic, or 120 hertz, is a negative sequence. The third, or 180, zero sequence. This pattern just repeats. So the fourth will be positive, the fifth negative, the sixth zero. Seventh positive, eighth negative, ninth zero. It's a repeating pattern. So you can easily tell which harmonics are positive sequence, negative sequence, and zero sequence. So when we look at this, we have such situations where you can have three-phase power supplies that have six pulse converters in them. These will create predominantly fifth-order harmonics, which are negative sequence. So these can actually create counter-rotational torques and motors or vibrations. THD, total harmonic distortion. Total harmonic distortion, when we look at total harmonic distortion, what we're actually looking at is the sum of all the harmonics on the system compared to the fundamental. And this is measured as a percentage of the fundamental. IEEE will tell you this value, voltage harmonic, voltage THD, should not typically exceed about 8%. That's our goal there. Okay. Now, THD is a great method to measure voltage harmonics. However, it's not necessarily fantastic for current harmonics because we're looking at it as a percentage of the fundamental. You typically always have a voltage there present, but you don't always have current present. So if the load turns off, your current measurement can go down. So if I'm looking at THD of current, if I'm drawing 200 amps and I have 0.2% THD, it'll come up as 3.16 THD on my current. But what happens if that load turns off and I'm drawing only about 200 milliamps? Well, then the THD will measure 100%. People will see that and say, oh my gosh, I got a big problem there. Well, you really don't, because you're not drawing any current. This is why IEEE 519 will recommend on current using total demand distortion, TDD. What it does is it takes the same sum of all the harmonics, but instead of averaging them or referencing them to the average current at the moment, what we do is we look at the entire test interval. We look at the maximum average current that was drawn during that test interval, and we use that as the reference throughout the entire test. So this way, even if the current value drops to very low, you still have a valid reference. So typically, total demand distortion is used as your measurement for your total harmonics on your current. And the last thing we're going to cover is rapid voltage change. I mentioned before, flicker is basically used for measuring incandescent lights. But what happens when you have different types of lighting, such as fluorescent? Rapid voltage change is basically, we said that sags and swells are when we get deviations of 10%. Rapid voltage change is caused by changes in the RMS below about 3% is the reference we use. And this will typically be seen causing lighting deviations in all different types of lightings, not just incandescents, but fluorescents, even LED, you can have these effects. So typically when we see lighting issues, we want to look at our rapid voltage change. Rapid voltage change is, we're going to be looking at the steady state of the voltage. We record that for a minute. Once the steady state's achieved, as soon as we get a change of 3% or more, we're going to start an RVC event. And that event will continue until steady state is reestablished. Once the steady state is reestablished, the RVC event will end. And this is where we can look at that and compare that to our flickering of our lighting changes that are occurring. What are some of the things that can create RVCs? Any sort of sudden changes in loads could do it, but one of the most common ones today is solar panels. Solar panels today, their output can change if you don't have good voltage regulation with them as a cloud goes overhead. So you can get sudden rapid voltage changes, and you can also see this in other forms of green energy, such as wind as well. So if we are getting complaints of lighting problems, rapid voltage change is one of the things we do want to examine. And Ron, I hand it over to you.
I appreciate that, Andy. Thank you for that presentation. We've attempted to give you a taste of power quality and harmonics in this presentation. I'd like to invite you to look at the slide here. We offer AVO courses in power quality and harmonics, power device coordination for utility and industry. We also have a power factor testing course and a short circuit analysis course. So
You've had about 45, 50 minutes of the presentation to give whet your appetite. These are the courses where we really get in hands-on labs to discover more about the subject. Also, on your screen now are the mega products that are recommended for this category, and you can see the MPQ 1000, the MPQ 2000, and the MPQ Simulator 01. These products are available at megger.com. You can get more information there. We'd like for you to save the date for our next webinar. It's Tuesday, June 26th from 1 to 2 p.m., same time, same station, Central Daylight Time, and the subject is Field Technician's Basic to Transformer Fundamentals. We're going to shift subjects a little bit, and what we're trying to do in our webinar series is to cover as much territory as possible to give you a more in-depth of the fundamentals of this particular situation. They'll be presented by Mike Carter. Mike is one of our training specialists and a curriculum advisor. Okay, now it's time to get into some questions, Andy. I'd also like to remind everybody once again that this presentation will be available at avotraining.com/webinars. We record all our presentations, and you will be able to get the recorded copy there. We'll also, as a reminder, be sending you out an email with the certification that you have attended this webinar. So let's dig in and let's see if we can answer some of these questions, Andy. We have quite a few questions, so we'll get to as many as we can. Okay, the first question. Please explain how solar panels can cause overvoltage. I thought grid-tied inverters, not being voltage-forming devices, only tracked and mimicked grid voltage.
It's going to depend very much on the inverter, what type of inverter is being used, and as you get tie into that grid. Right now, there is a push on to really start using smart inverters to help alleviate this problem. But what can happen is locally, within the residence, they can experience an overvoltage as well with that that occurs. There's many different types of inverters that are present with the solar panels, from micro inverters to the single phase inverters. And some of these, again, some of these are very well regulated. Others do see higher voltages that are occurring on the system due to these.
Andy, Richard would like to know, how is nominal voltage setting determined?
The nominal voltage setting is basically, if you look at your standards, it is the declared voltage on the system. In fact, if you look at the standards, it will be called UDIN, or the declared voltage. That is basically determined by the operator. Some of the common ones here are 120, but you could also have a declared voltage of 110. When we say the nominal voltage, this is the utility or the user-defined nominal voltage.
Okay, thank you, Andy. Matt wants to know, can you add more detail regarding the Class A instruments?
Yes. This is a good question here. Class A instrumentation. Back in the day, we had all different types of recorders that had all different types of proprietary methods of recording voltage. They could have varying sample methodologies and different methods of aggregation as well. Aggregation, what I mean is all the different samples. When we do a discrete measurement, which a digital recorder does, it takes periodic samples of the data and then has to aggregate that over a given time interval. So you had different methodologies being used, you had different aggregation times being used, and what would happen is you could get different measurements from one recorder to another. And the question came up, which one's right? The answer was, really, there was no answer. It was just how you wanted to measure it. So in Europe, they started what was basically referred to as the IEC 61000-4-30, which defined what a Class A recorder did. And they basically said the Class A recorder will aggregate the will sample the data at such a rate, aggregate it at such a rate, so that basically, when I use a Class A recorder, no matter of the manufacturer, when I use a Class A, my measurements should match. So most systems that are in substation are Class A. So typically, you always want to use a Class A recorder so you get apples-to-apples measurements.
Okay, another question is, nominal voltage different for 1 meter versus another meter located many miles away?
Mm-hmm. And yes, that can, but that's where that comes into where you're going to define UDIN, the declared voltage on the system. As you get down, again, remember what we're looking at. The goal here is to determine if we have a power quality problem, which means that is power quality causing something to fail, something to trip. So that has to be taken into consideration. If my declared voltage is 120 and down the line it's getting to 110 and I'm having a problem due to that, that's a power quality problem.
Thank you, Andy. Tyler asked this question. So on the VDFs, the VFDs,
yeah,
when they run high frequency, they let transients through easier. That's a question. Do they?
Really, when they run high frequency, it's not so much they're letting transients through, but they are creating. You can get transients created by the high frequencies that they are switching at, and you also can get high frequency harmonics due to their switching rates as well. These are also going to be very, those transients they create are also going to be very dependent upon the size of the load, the grounding, and also the length of the cable to that load. So you may see large amounts of overshoot on their switching if you have large loads or very large cable lengths as well. But what you will see on those is high-frequency harmonics as well.
Oscar wants to know, will low-frequency oscillatory transients impact insulation breakdown in equipment over time?
Any transient can create will over time will affect your insulation, because think about what you're doing. You're doing a rapid change in your voltage level, which means just like in a capacitor, it will allow it to go through. Okay, so over time, you always will have some type of stress put on it. And again, it's all going to depend on the insulation, the age of the insulation, the amount of the transient, the amount of energy in it as well, and how often it's being hit.
Andy, another question. Can one determine if motor overheating is due to harmonics or unbalance?
That's a good one. That's a good question. Typically, in unbalance, one of the first things you're going to look at when you're doing, if you're having a problem with the motor, you're going to want to hook up an analyzer as close to the motor as you can, and then you would do a recording. When you record that voltage, you record those values, you're going to look at your voltage unbalance and current harmonics as well. We want to see how unbalanced is that system. If you're seeing high levels of voltage unbalance exceeding 2%, then you want to look at your current imbalance. You're going to see much higher current imbalance. That's a sign of a problem. There's no clear-cut method to say, if it exceeds this, this is going to happen. If it exceeds this, this is going to happen. It's a dynamic system. It's going to depend, but you need to record both of them. And again, if you see your voltage imbalance going above 2%, that's a good indication that you're going to have some unbalance issues there that could be causing overheating. And again, you'll see that as one coil getting much hotter than the others. And of course, with your harmonics, we want to look at those negative sequence harmonics with those.
Andy, Pablo says that they are measuring flicker with an MPQ-1000 in medium voltage insulation. In one phase level, levels are above 1, the others are 0.7. What do you recommend to correct?
Well, if they're measuring well, first question would be, are they having light flicker issues there? because remember, what we're looking for is incandescent lighting issues. So really, when we look at power quality, it's not just a matter of looking at something and saying we're within a standard or outside a standard. If we're seeing a light flicker, if we have incandescent lights and they're flickering, and we see our flicker being above 1.0, we have to look what's causing this to happen. Are we also getting rapid voltage changes? What are our harmonics in there? We need to go a little bit further in there to see what the root cause of that is. It could also be interharmonics, which I didn't have an opportunity to touch on today, that can be leading to the sudden rapid voltage changes. So it's really a matter of finding the root cause. But the first question I would have for you is, are you seeing flickering lights with incandescent lighting? If you're not, this may not be an issue.
Andy, we've only got time for a couple more quick questions. So Ray wants to know, how do isolation transformers affect harmonics?
When we're dealing with harmonics, if you have voltage harmonics, remember, they will mitigate through a transformer. However, typically, current harmonics will not mitigate through a transformer, so that's where they can come in handy. But also keep in mind, one of the common transformers we use today is a delta to Y transformer. The reason a delta to Y transformer is used is that triplin or zero sequence harmonics won't propagate through them, even on the voltage, because they will get trapped in the delta side. There's no ground there for them to get over. So that's one of the key reasons we use delta to Y transformers, is
okay,
for harmonic mitigation.
Thank you, Andy. Time for one more question. And I do want to remind everybody that Andy will be answering questions via email if we don't get to them today. So I just wanted to let you know that your question will not go unanswered. Last question, Andy. Where is the best place to take measurements? At the panel or at the load?
That is a really good question. And like with most items, it depends. Is that, you know, what are you trying to accomplish? If I am trying to look at whether the problems on the utility side versus the customer side, I need to go to the point of common coupling, which is the panel. And I want to see where my issues lie there. If I have a particular piece of equipment that I'm having an issue with, then I want to get as close to that piece of equipment as I can to see what the actual power quality of is going into that unit, to see the voltages, the current, the frequency, the harmonics directly into that. Because the further I get away from it, the more diluted the results will get. So again, it depends on what your goal is there.
Again, thank you, Andy, for this presentation. We apologize if we haven't gotten to all your questions, but as I said, Andy will respond to the email after the webinar. I wanted to remind you one more time that you can get the recorded version of this webinar at avotraining.com/webinar. We hope to see you again June the 26th, same time, same place, with the subject Transformers. Thank you again all for viewing this webinar, and we look to see you the next time. Thank you.